Martin, you're kicking the loop off, right? Good morning. Thank you for joining our online worship community here at Journey. We're so excited that you've chosen to worship with us. We want you to be able to worship freely. This means you can sing as loud as you want, clap and dance. We also want you to continue to post in the comment section on Facebook and interact with others as part of the worship service. So welcome this morning.
Stop. Good morning, Journey family. How are you doing out there on the live stream? Go ahead and take a minute to interact, say hi, give your digital fist bumps, all those good things right there in the stream. Go ahead and like and share it while you're there. That'll help us out a ton in maximizing the number of people who get reached by this message. So when you give, when you support financially, we can support Hill Country Community Ministries, which is providing food and clothing, fans, blanket, all these needs that we have, especially during this time of COVID, right here in our community, in Leander, Cedar Park, North Austin. So when you give, we can support awesome ministries like Hill Country Community Ministries. And also, we've got a new series starting today as we look at Mark's gospel. We're going to be looking at Mark chapter 1 verses 1 through 13, the seal of approval. We're going to be digging into Mark's gospel over the next several weeks, and it's going to be great. I'm going to pray for us real quick, and we're going to continue to worship in song. Father, thank you so much for this body that we can gather, whether it's digital or in person, and God, that our praise is just rising up to you like a wonderful incense, Father. I pray that our worship would be genuine, that it would be from the heart, and it wouldn't be just going through the motions, Father. And we pray for your spirit to be working in our hearts, Father, as Mitch brings the word this morning. We pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. That stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. For it is. Shout.
we thank you for today that we can be together, even virtually, and we can hear from your word. We pray for Mitch now as he brings that you would speak to us personally, that we would learn from the servant king. In your name, amen.
Hello, Journey. We're back from sabbatical, so welcome. Hello. I'm glad you're here. Sherry and I want to say thank you so much to the board and the body for allowing us this time of refreshment. And definitely refreshed and ready to get back in the game and eager to start this new series. Sabbatical is great, and it sort of it changes your rhythms a bit. And so I was thinking about that this morning because I was trying to get ready for today. And I think, was it June the 28th was the last time I had to be ready on a Sunday morning to bring the word. And so I was thinking about this, and a couple of things came to mind. You know you're on sabbatical when you look down at your feet and you have Chaco tan lines. It's just like very distinctive striping, because that's basically what I've been wearing for the last month is just my Chacos. I know, don't be jealous. And another way you know you've been on sabbatical is when it's time to get back into the game and it's Sunday morning and you can't find any long pants. And so I thought about coming in shorts. I guess I'd be okay. You can't even see if I have shorts on. I may have shorts on, but I'll prove to you that I don't. I found them. Here they are, right here. So, yeah, we're glad to be back and start this new series. Say thanks to John and Crossline. John Webster is a longtime friend and a friend of the Journey as well. And thanks, John, for leading us and leading the team this morning. And it's still a crazy time of Corona. I didn't know what to expect after we got back from sabbatical, but we seem to be still in this same rhythm. And I was thinking about that a lot, just the varied realities that individuals and family have to deal with when considering personal safety. I was thinking about that a lot when it comes to the church community doing life online. And what I realized about myself as I experienced some online community as well, if you can put community in quotes, and I'm just being honest here, community that comes through my screen, is more often like entertainment, because biblical community is us being together, and that's sort of a mandate. Hebrews chapter 10 says that we should not give up the assembling of ourselves together, as some are in the habit of doing, but come together so that we can literally put our lives on each other and encourage each other and spur one another on toward love and good deeds. And so I'm going to challenge you, not everybody, and maybe just a small subset, but I think it's a larger subset than you might imagine. What I've realized is it's easy to fall into the habit of what I call spiritual apathy, where since March 15th, church for many of us, community for many of us, has been through a TV screen. And I think that's perfectly appropriate given some very real individual and family needs to maintain healthy distances. Well, what you may not know is that we have done an amazing job with a team here that is committed to your safety on Sunday morning with all of the protocols, and for some of you, even beyond the necessity, we have done a really good job of planning to the most extreme opportunity for safety. We've done all we can do, and we continue to maintain that environment for our 11 o'clock service. So here's my challenge to maybe a small subset, but maybe a large subset, who continue to do their church thing, your church thing at home. If you're okay in the grocery store during the week, if you're okay in the retail environment during the week, if you're okay in the restaurant or gym environment during the week, if you're okay doing as much routine as you need to do out of isolation with the proper protocols, if you're okay in the grocery, retail, restaurant, gym, or other environments, then you're more than okay here. And here's my challenge. You should be here. See, inertia comes when I get comfortable. And spiritual life should never be comfortable. I'm not saying it should be physically dangerous. Please don't hear me talking to everybody. But I'm talking to some. And I know that because I have that same tendency. So my challenge is, for those of you who are comfortable in the routine of your daily lives with the proper protocols in place, you should be here. That's it. Enough said? Type in enough said. So pray, consider, and we hope to see you at 11 o'clock, or maybe next week at 11 o'clock, because this is community. This is, we're designed to be together. And if you haven't experienced one of our services with people in it yet, you'll find that it's very gratifying and satisfying to be with the body in any size. So that's it for my challenge. You're welcome. I'm back. So now we're going to start this new series. On March 15th, speaking again of the corona chaos, everything shut down as far as our connection in community on Sunday and during the week and people being together. So on March the 15th, we did our first live stream service. The first part of April, I started producing almost every day of the week a study through the Gospel of Mark. And that was very well received, and I think it was helpful to a lot of people. It was also very helpful to me to stay connected to you in that way and be able to at least interact via our teaching and learning time daily on Facebook and YouTube through the Book of Mark. And I started that in early April. Now, I suspended that at the end. I didn't know how long it was going to go. Literally, I thought maybe it was going to be a few weeks or a few months until things ground back up to speed. But it kept going, and you know, we're still here. And so at the end of June, when it was time to go on sabbatical, I suspended it. But as I was thinking and praying about what to do when I got back, you know, the Spirit said to me clearly, hey, man, this walk through the gospel is so necessary for people to engage the historical, the physical space and time Son of God, which is all the Gospels are, is that exposition of Jesus historically, physically, as the divine Son of God. So I decided that we're going to start on Sunday mornings now. I'm going to go all the way back to the beginning, to Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 13, and we are going to use our Sunday morning time to walk through the Gospel of Mark. And for those of you who were many of you, and it was great to see y'all in our daily teaching. For those of you who say, oh man, I've already done that, believe me, it doesn't matter how many times you go through the text, there's always something new and fresh. And for me, even as I go and look at my outline, I have new spiritual insights and slightly nuanced ways of teaching and applying this same text as well. It doesn't matter how many times. This is, the Word of God is a deep ocean that can never be plumbed. And it's also shallow enough that you won't drown. Just an amazing thing about God's Word. So, we're going to start our journey through the Gospel of Mark, and I've titled the series Servant King, because that's how Mark expresses Jesus, as the servant sent via God's plan to redeem the world. And so I think it's good for us to talk about what a gospel is. There's four gospels in your Bible. They begin the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And the gospel, the word literally, euangelion in Greek, it means good news, good words, euangelion, a good message, good news. And so each of the gospels is a story of good news, a good message, good words. And so each of them is from a different perspective, Matthew's perspective, Mark's perspective, Luke's perspective, and John's. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time here. But what I want to say is these four perspectives have the same mission. And the mission is to reveal the reality that a gospel is not a story or a philosophy or a program. The gospel is a person. to embrace, a person to worship, and a person to obey. And you see this right out of the gate in Mark's gospel in the first chapter in verse 1. So the gospel, just like much of the New Testament, a lot of the Old Testament is very historical and is actually a history, like a complete history in some cases. But a gospel is historical, but it's not designed to be a complete history. Remember, the purpose of the gospel writers is to elevate and exposit or reveal Jesus. And so all of the history on either side and embedded into daily life is not included. As a matter of fact, in all four of the Gospels together, we have only probably about 55 parts of 55 or 60 days in Jesus' life that is being revealed and unpacked and shown to us to authenticate this beautiful person that we are to embrace, worship, and obey. And so it's historical, but it's not designed to be a history. It's real time, real people, real responses, and real reactions to Jesus. In that real-time history, there are crowds of people. There are people who are close to Jesus and stay close to Jesus. There are people who are curious who begin to follow Jesus and then fade away. There are religious leaders and there's governmental leaders. So in this historical account, in all of these Gospels, you see this real-time, real people and real responses and reactions to the person of Jesus. So what we're going to do here in Mark's gospel is we're going to walk through it really in as much detail as I think is necessary for us to get to that place where we decide and we understand that the person of Jesus is the person that we must embrace, worship, and obey. Now, Mark's gospel is only about 665 or 67 verses, the English translation, and that makes it the shortest gospel, the shortest of the four stories. And Mark writes to a Roman mind, and Romans like action. It's as close as possible to a Western mindset, where we like to see sequence. We like things linear. We don't like you to spend a lot of time circular, ride around, and refresh and review. We like to see action. And you'll see one of the features of Mark's language, the language that he uses is immediately then, after that, then they, quickly, immediate, after, immediately after these things. You see Mark moving from scene to scene. And Mark's gospel was used as a baseline source material for Matthew and also for Luke. Now, they all experience the same things with Jesus, but Mark's gospel is used as a sort of a pool from which the other two writers of the synoptics, now I'm getting way too deep, Matthew, Mark, and Luke are called the synoptic gospels because synoptic means seen from the same eye. And so Mark is the eye that produces material that then Matthew and Luke, they expand in many times. They don't embellish, they just expand. And so Mark is a fast-moving story of this person to embrace, worship, and obey. And so as we start in chapter 1, what I want to do is I want to look at the authentication purpose of Mark. From verses 1 through 13, you're going to see Mark first pronounce his purpose, and then you're going to see a series of processes by which his desire to have Jesus authenticated is affirmed by different people, including Jesus himself. So let's get started. I have a book recommendation that's helpful in historical and biographical study of the Gospels. And it's from the late Ravi Zacharias and Abdu Murray. This is Ravi's last book project. It's called Seeing Jesus from the East. So helpful. Sometimes we see Jesus as an American, and he's subject to the same things we are, the same foibles, the same decisions about fast food. But Jesus was brought at just the right time into a very different culture from ours by God's design into the nation of Israel. And it's helpful to get a picture of the historical Jesus so that you can have a context for understanding the Bible when you read it for yourself in the gospel. So the book is called Seeing Jesus from the East. I think our digital pastor may be putting that in for you. Ravi Zacharias and Abdu Murray. So get it, read it, love it. All right, so here we go. Week 1, authentication of the servant king, a study of Mark's gospel. So first I want to show you Mark's purpose. That's what I told you, is the authentication of one long anticipated. Now, in the history of Israel, there have been a lot of folks who wanted to be authenticated as the one that Israel was waiting for, her Savior, her Messiah. And they were all proven false, either by their lack of power or their alternate agenda, or the fact that they didn't last, they didn't persevere, they didn't make the cut. It's because they weren't truly the one called by God to be brought from the lineage of Israel, the tribe of Judah, through David, and most importantly, not the one who was divinely progenated by the Holy Spirit in the Virgin Mary. So Mark's purpose here in this entire book, and it's powerfully summarized in these opening 13 chapters, is to authenticate the one that Israel is long anticipating. Israel is under the dominating boot heel of Rome and waiting for the wrong Messiah. She's waiting for a Savior, the chosen one, the anointed one, that will relieve her of Rome's and every other nation's domination. She's looking for a military and political Savior. And she's looking with a short-sighted vision. So let me read through the entire text, and then we'll go back and walk through. I'm going to read through Mark. That's another thing that happened on sabbatical, is I fell in love again with having the text in my hand. Anybody still read the text like this? Like a page? Like it turns? Like you put your fingers on? Anybody do that anymore? It was really cool. I spent a lot of time with my beloved text. So here we go. Mark chapter 1, verse 1 through 13. The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. Now, as I read, just try to capture the ways that John is authenticating this person, this good news, this gospel embodied in Jesus. Just look at the many ways, and then you can compare notes as I walk through the text again. The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. And this is from Isaiah's book. I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so, evidently in answer to this prophecy, and so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a repentance, a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. And this was his message. Do you remember verse 2? I will send my messenger ahead of you. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. At that time, you see how John's moving so quickly. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice, here's another message, and a voice came from heaven. You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. At once, you see that? At that time, at once, the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted or tested by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. This is the word of God. And if you're Anglican, you say, thanks be to God. Any Anglicans? So let's walk back through and see Mark's purpose and then the process by which he explains to us how Jesus is authenticated. So the process here of authentication reveals Mark's purpose for the entire book. And it begins with what I would call the seal of approval from a variety of perspectives on the person and mission of Jesus Christ. And so we see now the process of this authentication. The first point of authentication, the first step is in prophecy. And Mark references the book of Isaiah, the beginning, verse 1, of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. I will send my messenger ahead of you. Now, this was a prophecy given to Isaiah the prophet about 700 years before Jesus appears on the scene. I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. So John the Baptist, as we'll see, is this messenger, and he is known as the forerunner, the one that goes ahead of Jesus, ahead of this divinely appointed and anointed Messiah. Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. So the process begins with a prophetic message about a prophetic messenger. And then we see the messenger and his message. This is the second point of authentication. What Isaiah spoke about this forerunner is now made real and true in this time and place in history, as Galatians says, in the fullness of time, God brought his son, born of woman, into the world. And John the Baptist is that forerunner. We see a messenger and his message continuing on in the text. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. This was common in Israel at this time. Baptism was this personal decision that I wanted to be in the water of the Jordan in order to externally cleanse my sins. And John was this popular preacher. I think part of his popularity was he was just so idiosyncratic. You see his clothing, you see his diet, and he was also popular to the people, at least, because he didn't stand with the religious leaders of the day who dominated and oppressed the people. As a matter of fact, he stood face to face with them and condemned their own sin and hypocrisy. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. Now, the last creature I saw eating a locust was my little red chihuahua last night in the backyard. And I'm telling you, it didn't look too tasty. I don't know if Mark didn't have anything else, or maybe that's a high-protein diet. I'm not sure. Maybe the wild honey made it go down easier. I have no idea. But John is this messenger that Isaiah talked about, and through God's anointing of Isaiah brought this message that there will be this one that is the forerunner of the good news, authenticating his identity. And this was his message, the messenger and his message. After me comes one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Now, if you know your four stories about Jesus, the four Gospels from four perspectives, you'll see particularly John the Apostle develops John the Baptist's ministry more comprehensively. And he says, John the Baptist says things referring to Jesus. He says, I must decrease and he must increase. And he also, we see this same statement that Jesus will baptize with fire and the Holy Spirit. It's a little bit expanded. So we see now that through the prophet and through the messenger, we begin to get this authentication that seals without question the historical and missional reality of this man, Jesus Christ. The third step of authentication, the third step in the process, is Jesus himself, the servant, and his humility. We see Jesus, who John has just said is going to baptize, we see him submitting to baptism in humility. So as part of God's plan for Jesus to go through the rigors of the customs, the religious customs of the day, in order to make sure all the sequences were correct. And you see this in another gospel when Jesus comes to be baptized and John says, hey, wait a minute, I need to be baptized by you. And Jesus says, no, this is the way we're going to fulfill all righteousness. But Jesus in his humility submits to this baptism from John. Continuing in the text, at that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And now we see the next step immediately in the authentication, and that is the affirmation of the Father as Jesus comes out of the baptism. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came down from heaven, you are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. Now, if you're in the text right now, I want you to go back to the beginning of John's message. He says the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And this is God himself saying, you are my Son, whom I love. So you see this tight little evidentiary affirmation taking shape as Mark begins his proclamation through these 600 plus verses of Jesus and his identity, his power, his mission, and his fulfillment of God's plan to bring redemption and its possibility to the world. The next step in the authentication is, again, Jesus himself. And this is the servant and his testing. And you see the action continue. Jesus comes up out of this posture of humility being baptized. He's affirmed by the Father. And there's no immediate celebration. It's not let's get the party on. It's let's test this man for the ministry he's been called to. Continuing. At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days. Say 40 days. Type in 40 days. Because I'm about to expand using Matthew's gospel, what happened in the desert. 40 days. He was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted or tested by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels attended him. One of the beautiful things about knowing the text at a fairly significant level is that you can see what one gospel writer says, and then you can go to those same events in many cases in the other gospels and get more expansion or more detail in one area or another. And Mark has in his style, he has this machine gun of at once, and then at that time. But Matthew does a great job giving us the deeper, expanded reality of what happened in these 40 days. And I'm going to read that, and this will be an exercise in understanding the rigors and the testing of Jesus as he was prepared for his ministry. Matthew chapter 4. So you see, if you look at the end, I'm sorry, am I geeking out a little bit? I'm geeking out a little bit. I guess I am. I don't know. Food. If you look at the end of chapter 3 of Matthew, you'll see the same source material. Verse 16 of 3, as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Now, then Jesus, chapter 4, verse 1, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted or tested by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, that's why I wanted you to put 40 in there. Can you imagine fasting 40 days and 40 nights and then undergoing the most grueling, rigorous spiritual testing and temptation that you'll ever endure? Can you imagine it? Say yes or no right now. Type it in. Nod your head. No? Can't imagine it? Don't want to? Who doesn't want to imagine it? I don't. I'd probably fall. I'd probably fail. I don't think I could even fast for a full day from everything, especially not ESPN. So he was, after 40 days, and Matthew in the master of understatement, after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry, and everybody said, The tempter, that's Satan, came to him and said, if you are the Son of God. Now these temptations are classically known as all the temptations that we, as God's creatures and followers of Jesus Christ, will also endure. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And this is common to your everyday experience. If you're a follower of Jesus, you will be tested regularly in these three areas. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Now, these are common to all people. And if you're a follower of Jesus, you will be regularly aware that the tempter desires you off of the narrow path. If you are the Son of God, the tempter said, tell these stones to become bread, the lust of the flesh. It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. You see that Jesus, he confronts temptation with a knowledge of Scripture. That's really a good model for all of us. When temptation comes, you should have a deep well of the Word of God to combat the temptation. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple, that's Jerusalem, at the highest point of the most magnificent building in Jerusalem. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. And that is the pride of life. Jesus answered him, it is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Verse 8, again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their splendor. Showed him the eye gate. All this I will give to you, Satan said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. This is the lust of the eyes. And Jesus rebuked Satan, as it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. So what we see in Mark as a brief soundbite, Matthew expands for us, and what we know now is that Jesus has been authenticated for this mission and ministry that he's been given. He's been affirmed through the words of the prophet, the truth of the messenger coming through the prophecy. He's been affirmed by his own humility in his baptism. He's been affirmed by the Father's statement that he is his son, and in him he's well pleased. And he's been affirmed by his successful perseverance, endurance, and satisfaction of the testing. And so this is how Mark sets the stage. And Matthew uses the same kind of process. This is how Mark sets the stage for now Jesus' life and engagement with crowds, disciples, curious followers, and religious and spiritual leaders, or religious and civil leaders. And so as we come to a close here, point number three, what to expect in Mark's gospel. You're to expect Jesus continuing to prove himself in his words, his actions, his posture, his demands, his expectations, his humility, his servanthood. This is how Mark continues to present Jesus as a servant, but not as a weak, squishy servant, a servant who's been now delegated the responsibility of bringing the possibility of redemption to all mankind. And in his mission fulfillment, the servant will serve every single one of us at our most basic need with the opportunity to have our sins forgiven as he has been our servant substitute. So what to expect for the rest of this gospel, and I encourage you to read through this gospel yourself several times, is that Jesus now proves, regardless of responses, regardless of acceptance or rejection, he continues to prove his identity as the one designated by the prophet and now fulfilled in his role and mission. But this is what matters most, is that you come to a place, because you're part of this group that's always responding to Jesus. In the gospel, we'll see the crowds, we'll see the curious, we'll see those who remain close. and desire to continue to walk with him. We'll see the religious people who somehow feel like a law is more important, behavior is more important than spirit-filled living. We'll see the governmental or political types who want their spiritual life to sit on a platform of their party affiliation. So what matters most is you come to a place by reading honestly the history, the historical, the biography, the biographical, the proof in historical text of deeds, of words, of affirmations, of miracles, of healings, of arrest, of torture, of crucifixion and death, and resurrection and life, that you come to a place where you willingly, eagerly embrace, worship, and obey Jesus Christ. That is Mark's goal. That is our goal. My desire for you is that you willingly, eagerly embrace, worship, and obey Jesus Christ. It is the journey of a lifetime. Where are you on that journey? If you say, man, I fail for it, but I'm willingly, eagerly embracing, worshiping, and obeying Jesus Christ, just type in, I'm in. Just type it in. I'm in. The angels rejoice. And it's a journey. And that's another reason you need community. You need to be with other believers, because the tempter is always desiring to take you from the narrow path and have you choose life outside the guardrails, where there only is darkness and destruction. I'd love to hear from you. You can PM me if you want to discuss, you know, give me a private message on Facebook or any other way, email, if you want to discuss what it means to come to a place of willingly and eagerly embracing, worshiping, and obeying the Savior of the world, who served you for the forgiveness of sin and resurrection to new life. Let's pray. Father, thanks for your magnificent word and your magnificent Son. Thanks that we have historical, biographical, evidentiary proof of his mission fulfilled. We have it in the history of the prophets hundreds of years before his arrival. We have it in the messenger of the one prophesied also, as he came and said, prepare the paths, make straight the paths, level the paths for the coming of the Lord. We have it in the humility of the servant. We have it in the affirmation of the Father. And we have it in the proof of Jesus now satisfying the test required to be the one and only, the sui generis of all of your plan, the one and only divine Son of God made man for the forgiveness of sin, for the redemption of sinners, and for life now, beginning in this moment, forever satisfied. As for me, Lord, I willingly, eagerly embrace, worship, and desire to fully obey your Son who died for me. And all the willing and eager said together, amen.
Hope we have our God, not dead. He's alive. stands high over the grave.
Experience. Come on, get some. All right.
Thank you.